Hello friends, welcome to Share Market Friend again. Today I'm going to talk about basic aspects, or I'm going to share my understanding related to Embassy Office Parks REIT, which was subscribed around 2.5 times on the day of closing of its IPO that came out on 18th of March 2019. This is the draft offer document, basically prospectus related to this REIT. It is available on SEBI website. As you can see, the manager of this Embassy REIT is Embassy Office Parks, and then sponsor is also Embassy as the sponsor, and Blackstone is also a sponsor, co-sponsor along with Embassy for this REIT. Its trustee is Axis Trustee. Okay, this video or this document is all about basic aspects related to this REIT. What is it contains in its portfolio? A lot of people are concentrating only on simply overall available data related to this REIT. So many people are ignorant about this prospectus, its basic documents. I think that is the important thing to learn about this REIT, to study this REIT. So we'll try to explore this prospectus or offer document of this REIT. It keeps updating, and a lot of data keeps updating, keep changing every day. So please refer the original document available on SEBI before proceeding for any decisions related to this REIT. Also refer my disclaimer below this video. Okay, these are the snaps or pics related to this REIT. This is Embassy Manyata, which constitutes major part of this REIT. It's in Bangalore. Then this is First International Financial Center in BKC, Bandra Kurla Complex in Mumbai, you can say. Then this is Embassy Cubics. You can get idea through this images that what basically portfolio of this REIT constitutes. Due to so many regulations related to issuance of REIT, this is actually one of the biggest REIT in Asia and first for India also. There are a lot of regulations related to REIT where they are required to carry 80% of portfolio, which will be completed and income generating portfolio, and also they cannot invest more than 20% into a vacant land or kind of thing which does not generate income, and also they have to distribute at least twice a year the dividend or income whatever is generated from this portfolio they are having, real estate portfolio. Basically, in simple terms, if I try to explain the what is this REIT, it is like you must have observed so many shops around you. They suppose there is a shop which costs around 1 crore rupees, and the owner of that shop transfers the total right, total ownership right of that shop into a trust called XYZ REIT, and issues 50% of that trust units into form of a share, pricing each share for particular price depending on the 1 crore valuation of the shop and future expectation from the shop. So whenever you buy that one unit of share of that from that trust, you are buying basically the shop or a part of a shop. So it is same like for REIT, but in REIT the scope will be huge, larger, and lot of mall like real estate assets, golf clubs or real estate related various assets will be there in this portfolio. We will try to explore what this Embassy REIT portfolio contains. This is basically a table of contents, index of this. This prospectus or offer document is of 650 pages, out of which around 100 pages are mostly annexures, and remaining 500 pages are basically all the details, all the plus points and threats related to this investment into this REIT. So we'll try to explore those, basically the plus points and minus points of this, where you can get a simple and important idea whether and how to invest and how to trade this investment. As so many financial advisors advise that you should have some investment, in a simple rule, not as a professional financial advisor, in a simple rule, a lot of people invest into gold, and some part into real estate, some part into equity. So if you want to invest in real estate, then, and if you don't have a budget more than 2-3 lakh currently, or you want to take a small risk into it, then I think this could be one option, because the minimum investment for investing into this is in the range of 2.5 lakhs. So when it will get listed on exchanges, it will be available for trading subject to the liquidity. So if you want to invest into this REIT, in this real estate which contains a great real estate properties into it, you can invest it just by 2.5 lakh. So that will be a great thing, a new investment avenue for Indian investors, also for FIIs. As you can see, recently what news related to REIT, we can understand is that a lot of big institutional investors like family company of Radhakrishna Damani, who owns the successful retail chain of DMart, also Fidelity International Fund, all such marquee investors and investing into its anchor portfolio, they have invested into it, subject to listing on exchanges, that keep into mind. Okay, so we'll check out the executive summary first. First, they have given that we are the owner of high quality office portfolio in India that serves as essential corporate infrastructure to multinational tenants and has significant embedded growth prospects. So basically, in one line, if you want to define embassy office parks, they own corporate infrastructure for multinational tenants. They have many IT companies like IBM, Capgemini, etc., which are tenants into their office infrastructure. So that here you can see it is mentioned here, such as JP Morgan, Google, Microsoft. So that gives a big guarantee or assurance for their quality of infrastructure and future credibility. Here they have shown the asset or portfolio into this. Okay, if you see here, the first, I'll zoom into it. The first one is Embassy Manyata, which constitutes mainly around 40-50% into the total portfolio. The whole portfolio is spread across four cities. Majority of the portfolio spread across four cities, that is Bangalore, Mumbai, Pune and Noida, and most of it is in Bangalore, that is around 40%, and around 15% into Mumbai and 15% into Pune, and Noida has a small around 8-10%. Okay, and remaining part is spread into 5-6% at various places like Four Seasons at Embassy One, Hilton at Embassy, Golf Links. Okay, the current market value for all this is 30,000 crore, you can say, as it is mentioned in millions. So it is around 30,000 crore total valuation, out of which they are selling around 20%, I think, units they are selling into this IPO. So that will be around 5,000 crore rupees they are taking out money from the market through issuance of units. Okay, here they have mentioned all the competitive strengths and business strategy for this REIT. So let's check one by one and try to understand what their plus points and what great things we get if we buy into this REIT. First is that they are located in India, a leading services hub for global corporates. They are saying that India is the sixth largest and the fastest growing major economy in the world and has become a leading services hub for global corporates over the last 20 years. Multinational companies are attracted to beneficial cost structure that is over 85% lower than tier 2 cities in United States and large English speaking talent pool. Okay, so basically based on lower cost of rents into India compared to the tier 2 cities of America and England or European countries, and the plus point of huge number of English speaking talent into India. So that is a future guarantee they are assuming, that that could lead to a better services hub, and in turn, if people are coming to India for investment into this new talent pool, they will definitely require offices. So this REIT is in the business of providing class one or top class infrastructure for such IT companies or multinationals. So that is a big opportunity for this REIT. Second, best in class office opportunities with high quality infrastructure at attractive capital values. They are saying that we own 7 best in class office parks and 4 prime city center office buildings totaling 32.6 million square feet of leasable area, making us the largest REIT amongst comparable Asian office REITs. As I told you earlier, this is the biggest REIT of Asia and they have best in class office parks, so that is a plus point for them. Then they have highly occupied by a diversified, high quality, sticky multinational tenant base. So their asset have 90% committed occupancy, means they are getting a fixed rent from fixed customers who are not changing their offices from their infrastructure for a long time. So that makes them sticky multinational tenant base, in which there are customers like JP Morgan, DBS, Swiss Re, Google, McKinsey, IBM, L&T Technology Services and Nokia, etc. So they mostly they are saying that our tenants are truly international, with approximately 81% of gross renters contracted with leading multinational corporations and approximately 43.8% of gross renters from Fortune 500 companies. So they are getting 43% of their gross renters from Fortune 500 companies. Then next point is that simple business model with strong embedded growth. They are saying, while our portfolio is highly stabilized due to the long-term nature of our leases to high-quality tenants, we are well positioned for organic growth on account of vacant space lease-up, contracted revenue on existing leases, re-leasing potential on lease expiries, and delivery of planned on-campus developments. So they are talking about, they are actually basically explaining that they have simple business model which is executed through contractual escalations, re-leasing of existing tenants at market rents, also lease up of existing vacancy, delivery of planned development projects in our parks, then disciplined acquisition strategy with strong balance sheet. So that all is leading to a simple business model and strong embedded growth potential in for the future. Next point they are saying as a plus point is that strategically located in top performing markets with high barriers to entry. So it is obvious thing that their most of office spaces are located into the major cities like Bangalore, Mumbai, Noida, that is near to Delhi, then Pune, etc. So that leads to a strategic location, top performing markets status to them. Then they have highly experienced management team drivers value through proactive asset management. They are saying that they are led by Michael Holland, who was the former country head of JLL India, that is a very renowned and big company into the infrastructure and real estate related field, that is JLL. So their ex former country head is with them, right, currently with Embassy REIT. Also Vikash Khadloya, I think some letter is missing into this name, Vikash Khadloya, who will be the DP deputy CEO or chief operating officer of the manager prior to the listing of units. And they have a good around 20 years of experience, other team member around 20 years of experience into operating, developing, leasing and managing commercial estate in India. So that was all about experience and manpower. Then there are renowned sponsors with global expertise and local knowledge. They have big sponsors who are into the business of real estate, and very big sponsors actually. They are Embassy sponsor and Blackstone sponsor. So that gives them a big strength to their overall potential. Okay, so this was all about basic plus point. Actually, overall, this is a successful company which is running profitably. So it overall brings out a plus point out of the situation. But as it is a business and as it is an investment, it carries risk also along with it. If it is coming up with some better profit potential, then it also comes with some risk factors into it. So there are mostly around 40 risk factors they have listed into this document. We'll try to see the basic idea, or I'll try to share my basic understanding related to this risk factor. First, they are mentioning that it is a basic that we have not executed binding agreements with respect to formation transactions and all. So they are saying that all this process is into the progress. So they are people are bidding for the units and they have not received units. We have not completed all the offer document. Once the bidding process gets completed, all the documents get signed from everyone and the transaction happens, then only they can confirm that this transaction is completed. So that is basic inherent risk to any transaction kind of thing. That is what I understood. And also further, we will assume existing liabilities in relation to the portfolio liabilities if lies. And they are also talking about liability, as I have read into newspaper also, that they will be offloading their liability amounting to around 20% of the total valuation of this REIT. So they have a huge loan onto them. So once it gets listed, they will be in a position to get off that loan or that liability related to portfolio. So that will be a risk subject to execution. Second, the units proposed to be sold in offer for sale have not yet come into existence, so it is same like above. Third, after the completion of the issuance listing units, we intend to obtain external debt financing. So that is, they have already talked about liability, so it is extension to that. They're talking about financial indebtedness. Okay, then fourth is, there we may utilize a significant amount of debt in the operation of our business and our cash. So they are mentioning the impact of above 2 points, that if they use the cash generated from the selling of units and all related money, whatever they generate from into it, if they utilize it for financing the debt, their operational ability may get impacted, their cash flows may get impacted. So that could be a risk, though it may materialize or not. Fifth is, we do not have any assurance or guarantee of any distributions to the unitholders. We not be able to make distribution to unitholders in manner described. So they are again explaining in other words the first and second points. So jump to the sixth point. The REIT regulations impose restrictions on the investment made by REIT. As I told you at the start of this, that there are so many regulations, as it is a new field, new avenue for investors in India. SEBI has put in lot of difficult conditions for the issuer of this REIT or every REIT. They will have to invest around 80% of their total, the portfolio should be into the income generating and completed assets. So that could be a restriction for them for easy and flexible movement into asset acquisition and related expenses things. Seven, the proposed holding and financing structure of the portfolio may not be tax efficient, as this point actually talks about basic tax leakage factor. If you see that if you are investing into REIT, being investment into a fund related to real estate, it will be subject to tax in the range of 10%, 15%, 20%, depending if you are paying stamp duty, if you are investing for lesser than 36 months, more than 36 months. So that will depend on to your investment parameter, investment method into it. Also, there are so many rules and regulations are there related to dividend distribution tax, based on if a issuing authority is directly held by the owner, the tax will be different. And if it is held by secondary company, suppose if I'm owner of company name A and company name A is owner of company name B and company name B is part of REIT, then tax treatment is difficult and deteriorating or creating a tax leakage into system. So that risk they are posing, as there are few SPVs into this REIT, those carry such structure of ownership. Okay, now they are talking about risks related to our business and industry. They have classified risks on the basis of different parameters. So it is a second type of risk related to business and industry. That is, our business is dependent on the Indian economy and financial stability. So it is basically overall risk that is subject to every business into India, as all the businesses are depending on their field of expertise or field of product. They are subject to exchange rate risk, then risk related to inflation, risk related to credibility of country, as well as credibility of the owner, etc. So overall business risk is there. Ninth, we have limited operating history. So they are talking about their past. Basically, they are into this business mostly from last 3 years. That is what I have understood from news and all the understanding. Actually, there is no precise number of years mentioned anywhere in the news that I got to. If you know that, please mention it into the comment box. So basically, they are saying that they have lesser experience into this field, so it will be difficult, or it is a risk thing that carries into this investment, so it can affect their future performance. 10th risk they mentioned, that a significant portion of our revenues are derived from a limited number of large tenants. Here they are mentioning that that 40 to 50% of their tenants are basically concentrated into top 10. You can say those are like IBM, Cognizant, technology solution. Those two account for the most, that is around 26%, and top 10 account for mostly 45 to 50%. So that is a tenant concentration risk. It is mentioned as a risk because suppose there are two tenants, those are IBM and Cognizant, they account for 26%. For some God forbidden reason, anything happens and these two back off from taking, being a customer of this REIT, being a tenant of this REIT, it will directly take a hit of around 26% to this REIT. It may not happen, it is very rare scenario, but this is a risk they have mentioned. They also mentioned that they have sector concentration, park and sub-market concentration into it. Sector concentration because most of their infrastructure is in the field of IT tenant for the companies related to IT sector, like they are mostly operating in SEZs, etc., which are restricting them into for getting tenants related to IT. So that is a risk. If IT sector gets affected due to any slowdown, etc., their tenant addressing capability will definitely can get impacted. Okay, next point is tenant leases across portfolio subject to the risk of, there is a risk that their tenant may not renew their lease for occupying the place. So that is a risk. 12th, our business and profitability are dependent on the performance of commercial estate market. So they basically depend on real estate market because most of their portfolio is in the business of real estate. 13, our actual results may be materially different from the expectations. So it is a common thing for every business apart from, along with real estate. So it will definitely will be there. Next is the valuation reports obtained for our portfolio based on various assumptions may not be indicative of the true value of our assets. So there is an error of valuation or analysis they have mentioned, that for overall calculation for valuation, when they are putting out 300 rupees per unit price, they are definitely valuing the overall asset that we have seen as 30,000 crore as total market value. So for that valuation, whatever the parameters, whatever the expectation assume, a particular model must have used. So that is subject to error because it may be indicative of true value of their assets. Nobody can calculate it perfectly. And also 15th, we may be required to record significant charges to earnings in the future when we review our portfolio for potential impairment. So in future, being a real estate real estate investment, there could be a big impairment into their portfolio. Could be because of natural calamity, could be because of any plant and equipment related issue, kind of generators, all the use, etc. into it. Kind of, I'm just giving example. So that is a risk for their potential impairment. They could be significantly charged to the portfolio. 16th, our contingent liability could adversely affect our financial condition, results of operation, cash flows. So currently they have liability, so that could affect their overall ability for operations and cash flows. 17th, we rely on third party operators to basically they operate their infrastructure to by third party operators, so that could be a risk. The third party operators may not perform as per the expectation. 18, compliance with and changes in environmental laws and regulations. So any change in environment, like it was affected, for example, for Vedanta, their one plant was shut down by environmental verdict or laws related to it. So that could be a big risk for a REIT. 19th, if you are unable to maintain relationship with the other stakeholders portfolio, as the stakeholders include various SEZs, MMRDA, and all related infrastructure related entities, so that relation in maintaining liability could affect them. 20 number, we are exposed to variety of risks associated with safety, security, and crisis management. This is a common risk for so a lot of real estate companies and institutions and businesses also. And 21 number, we may be unable to successfully grow our business in new markets in India. So this business or this field through REIT is basically new for India, so that is a risk of newness. Number 22, we may be adversely affected if the asset SPVs and investment entity are unable to obtain, maintain, renew all regulatory approvals. So regulatory risk is there, that is common for every business. 23, some of portfolio assets are located on land lease from government of Maharashtra. So a few of their lands are in MIDC, SEZ, etc. So they are subject to those regulations and changes. Number 24, we have entered into material related party transactions, the terms of which may be unfavorable for us, could involve conflict of interest. So they do have some related party transactions, as they have mentioned it in detail, it into related party transactions, so that could impact their overall performance, that could have some impact into it. 25, solar operations are dependent on regulatory. Solar operations, I don't think that's a big issue. 26, number 26, our asset SPVs and investment entity are subject to ongoing compliance requirements, and under various laws there have been certain passes of non-compliance. They are mentioning here that based on there have been certain past instances of non-compliance related to SPVs, that is special purpose vehicles, based on different acts, so that is a risk for future also. Number 27, some of portfolio assets are located in lands notified, as I mentioned it earlier, SEZ and MIDC, etc. Number 28, the title and development rights or other interests or land where the portfolio located may be subject to legal uncertainties. As this basically this investment is related to a portfolio of real estate, so I personally think that it will definitely be subjected to developmental issues, then legal ownership issues, etc. So that I think could be a common thing unless it is very big in impact. Number 29, there can be no assurance that they'll be successfully complete future questions efficiently. So they are saying that it could be in future difficult to acquire different real estate asset to add into this portfolio if they have any surplus cash using through it, because SEBI has mandated for them to distribute every surplus. They cannot keep more than 80% as non dividend generating or income generating asset or non-completed asset. So that is related to this, I think. Then number 30, there may be conflicts of interest between the lead managers and the associates and affiliates and the managers. So there could be a conflict of interest as these all sponsors and managers are into the same business. So that could affect it. Number 31, we may not be able to successfully meet working capital expenditure requirement of our portfolio asset due to inability of funding or etc. It is same like I explained earlier or related to that. Number 32, we may invest in under construction asset project which may adversely affect. So they are saying is that subject to based on their investment methods, they may invest in under construction real estate projects that may take some time to complete to generate income in future. So that could be could be a small risk to the portfolio. Number 33, the audit report. Here one important point they have mentioned that I think this is one of the important point I found into this all this. They are saying that they have around 861 crores liability or loan advances for MPPL, which is part of this REIT, and around 206 crore for UPPL, and out of which around 191 crore they have received back, and for the second one they have received around 105 crore, around half. But out of this 861 crore, around 600 to 700 crore still remains. So that they have mentioned into the audit condensed combined financial statement notes also as a note number 45. So I think this needs a more clarification or understanding, as I also didn't understand that they have such a huge loan advance pending for their MPPL unit. That I think could impact them in future, so that could be a big risk for their portfolio. That is what I think it may not be, or maybe I am perceiving it in a wrong way. Okay, so number 2034, our portfolio assets and the investment equity may be subject to increase in direct expenses, the operating expenses. So there is a issue, there could be issue of taxes and renovation work, repair and maintenance of physical damaged portfolio assets. So all related expenses can impact their future earnability. Number 35, we may be subject to certain restrictive covenants under our financing agreement that could limit our flexibility managing a business to use cash assets. As I told you, I have explained the same point earlier, kind of same point. Number 36, the Blackstone sponsor has not entered into a deed of right of first offer in respect of any assets operated by Blackstone sponsor group or either other entities of the Blackstone sponsor group, which could lead to potential conflict of interest. So as the point itself explains this, the Blackstone sponsor has not entered into a deed of right of first offer in respect of any assets operated by Blackstone. So it is kind of conflict of interest because they don't have preferential kind of treatment contract with Blackstone sponsor group. 37, the ROFO did enter into the embassy sponsor subject to various terms and conditions. This is the ROFO. It is a separate deed explained into this report. You can check it out. It is subject to the various terms and conditions into this ROFO deed. Then number 38, the brand embassy, is about the brand embassy where they are paying around 1 lakh per month. So they are talking about its impact if they are stripped of this embassy trademark or brand. Number 39, we operate in a highly competitive environment. So there is a lot of competition nowadays into the business of real estate, so that could impact their ability. Number 40, we may not be able to maintain adequate insurance. They are saying that it's not possible to insure everything and to get everything out of insurance in case a calamity or problem occurs. So that is a risk into this business. Number 41, there is outstanding litigation regulatory actions. Here they have mentioned all the related cases or litigations related to direct tax, indirect tax, material litigation, regulatory proceedings, property tax, out of which I found this one bigger, that is around 109 crore regulatory proceedings related to embassy REIT. Then around 96 crore for property tax. then 27 crore, 38 crore for tax related. Then there is bigger one, 163 crores for indirect tax associates of the embassy sponsor. Then 32 crore, 51 crore, 15 crore for tax related things. Oh, all this adds up to around, you can say 100, 200, around 1,300, you can say 300 to 400 crore it amounts to, I guess, all these litigations. Then there is number 42, our business may be adversely affected by illiquidity of real estate investment. So it's obvious thing, all businesses gets affected by liquidity, and especially real estate, because there is not much official liquidity into the market. Okay, then number 43, this draft offer documents contains information from the CBRE report. Basically, they have used CBRE report for many calculations, valuations, etc. And one of somewhere they are related to CBRE, CBRE is kind of property manager for some of their SPVs, etc. So that could be a risk for calculations, etc. or assumption by somebody who is part of itself or related to them. Number 44, lease deeds with some of our tenants are not adequately stamped or registered. So it's a related kind of process related risk they have mentioned, related to stamping and registering of deeds, etc., related to real asset, real estates. Then number 45, security and IT risk, that is a common thing and obvious. Number 46, foreign account tax compliance. As I have explained in one of my videos, you can check it into videos. If you click on Share Market Fan and go into the videos, you can find video on what is FATCA and what is all this international foreign account tax compliance related issues. So they are subject to this withholding may affect or related issues. Number 47, we expect to be classified as passive foreign investment. It is kind of same related to issues related to US and European points. Risk related to our relationship with the sponsors and manager. It is a third kind of risk they have defined. It's number 48, we and parties associated with us are required to maintain the eligibility conditions specified under regulations 44 of the REIT regulation, as well as certificate of registration on ongoing basis. They have talked about risk related to maintaining relations with parties associated with them. Those are Blackstone, embassy sponsor, and manager itself. That is embassy group. Then number 49, our sponsors will be able to exert significant influence. They are saying that their sponsor, that is embassy group, is owning around 51% into their share capital of the manager. So basically embassy has a controlling stake into it, so they can influence this overall process or overall decision taking ability of the manager. Then they have number 50, conflicts of interest may arise out of common interest. I explained this point earlier, common business risk. Then they have number 51, certain principals and employees may be involved in and have greater financial interest. So there is a risk of kind of few employees could have a special involvement, greater financial interest into the performance of other real estate investments, projects and business of the embassy group or Blackstone, and such activities may create conflicts of interest in making investment decisions on our behalf. So that is related to people involved in internal decisions, involved in owning particular property or etc. It is kind of complex risk. I am unable to explain actually. Number 52, we depend on managers and his personnel for success. They are basically saying that if their managers fails, they are helpless. So that is a obvious and common thing. Then it's number 53, we depend on managers to manage our business assets. It's kind of same. Then there is a fourth type of risk defined, risk related to India. Due to it is base, first they have talked about number 54, that is basically related to REIT regulations, as SEBI has put forth very difficult REIT regulations. So that is a kind of risk, as it comes as a limitation to overall business functioning. Then there is number 54, our performance is linked to stability of policies. Political situation itself is a risk. Number 56, any downgrading of India, if there is a downgrade to India's sovereign debt rating, so it will be difficult for them to raise money from foreign and overall debt market, so that could impact their operations. Then there is a significant difference exists between accounting practices of India, US and all other nations, so that could be a risk for overall valuations and calculations in case there are investors based into US and other foreign markets. Number 58, it may not be possible for REIT holders to enforce foreign judgments as it is registered in India, so it will be subject to Indian civil code or Indian laws and Indian jurisdiction. Then number 59, tax laws are subject to change as tax may change on REIT, it may change on dividends, etc. So that's a risk. Number 60, investor may be subject to Indian taxes arising out of capital gains. As I mentioned earlier, that depending on various scenario like STT paid, STT not paid, units withdrawn before 36 months, after 36 months, it is subject to that risk. Then there is number 61, land is subject to compulsory acquisition by government and compensation levy of such acquisition may be inadequate. So there is a land acquisition act by government of India where they can acquire any land required for their official requirements, so that could impact their overall functioning in case they collide with the government plans, etc. That is what I understood from this point. Then there is number 62, we may be subject to the Competition Act, so Competition Commission can impact their operation. Then there is a fifth type of risk they have defined, is a risk related to the ownership of the unit. It is number 63, trust such as ours may be dissolved. So it is a basically trust, though it is irrevocable, something bad can happen, something wrong can go, and it may be dissolved, so it is subject to that risk. Then number 64, the reporting requirements, other obligations listed investment trust post listing are still evolving. The level of investment made to protection granted to holders may be more limited than those made to shareholders of a company that listed securities. It is related to basically SEBI, as it may change, and it has the developing rules related to REIT and all listing related laws, so we are subject to risk evolving out of that, evolving maturity of our overall sector and rulings related to investment. That's what I understood. Then number 65, fluctuation in exchange rate. So exchange rate risk is there related to dollars, related to pound, and overall that impacts the debt, overall debt generated from foreign markets and overall real estate markets for investment in itself. Number 66, unit holders are unable to require the redemption of their units. Holders will not have the right to redeem units, request redemptions manager while units are listed on stock exchanges. So it is subject to the manager may repurchase units at its sole discretion if it is had obtained has obtained the prior approval unit holders in general meeting by. So unit holders will not have the right to redeem units or request or require the redemption of units by the manager. So you cannot force manager to redeem your unit. That is a risk. Number 67, the units have never been publicly traded and listing of the units may not be result in actual liquidity. So there wouldn't be any liquidity into the overall units trading of this REIT. So that is a obvious risk subject to the market availability for selling. If you want to sell your units and if there is no liquidity, your overall pricing may get impacted. That is basically counted into the impact cost. So impact cost could be high into this case. Number 68, the price of units may decline after the issue. So it is obvious risk that after listing it may trade at below 300 rupees price of listing, or it may trade above that, so that could be a plus point. If below, it would be a risk. Number 69, any future issuance of units by as or sales of units by Embassy Council of Blackstone. So in case currently they are unloading around 20-25% of total unit total valuation of this Embassy REIT, in future if they unload their more units into the market, it could dilute overall valuation, or overall it could impact the pricing of existing units. Okay, there are 5 to 7 points are remaining into the threats area. Number 17, no investors permitted to withdraw lower their bids once they are submitted bid. So once you submitted bid, you cannot withdraw it, not permitted. Number 71 are rights and rights of holders to recover claims by manager. So in case they default on loans and etc. So their rights to rights of unit holders to recover claims are limited. 72, NAV per unit may be diluted if further issues are priced below the current NAV per unit, as it is explained earlier. 73, compliance with European Union directive, it is related to European Union regulations and administrative issues. There is a risk. So these were all the risks related to Embassy REIT. Here onwards, they have explained what this REIT contains, what its portfolio. They have basically explained. Here you can see they have shown the basic schematic diagram. Here you can see it is unit holders. Then in right side trustee, they have shown left side manager managing all this. Basic in center, it is Embassy REIT, which holds the assets SPVs and managed by in right side trustees, and all the fees and their movements and property fees they have shown by arrows. If you check out further data here, they have explained overall real estate related business outlook, overall GDP related outlook. They have given various graphs for explaining how India GDP is improving day by day, month by month, and year on year, and how its property market is compared to the property markets of Turkey, Russia, Brazil, South Africa, etc. Our currency depreciation rate, and also in detail they have explained various real estate status of Pune, real estate status of Bangalore, real estate status of Mumbai, MMRDA, real estate offices status of Noida. They have explained and compared current office infrastructure availability, what is the demand for that office for each city, and each, even they have explained in detail for each REIT portfolio SPV, that is special purpose vehicle, for that demand, for that their history, they have explained it here. If you want to check it out in detail, what is the history for particular, suppose the major part is from Bangalore, so you can check out that how many square feet of offices are available into the Bangalore, and how much of it is into this REIT, and compared to world average rate of real estate, Bangalore, Pune, Mumbai, they are competing with very positive rates, they are giving very cheaper rates. So there is a future scope for this REIT that they have explained here through various diagrams, comparisons, pie charts. They have shown that each city owns how much sector in geographical distribution, and all and all. Basically, you need to if you check out one of it, you will be able to understand the remaining one, and just by seeing graphs, I think you can analyze others also. Once you study the one, or once you read one, they have also provided location graphs for particular real estate portfolio. Like this is in Embassy Golf Links near Inner Ring Road or HL Old Ring Road in, I think it's for Bangalore, they have shown here. They have explained all the assets, whichever they are classified as lifestyle infrastructure, the social infrastructure, key office developments, and also given name of tenants, from how many years they are there, which are the major tenants, all the things they have explained into this report. Same thing they have done for all the four cities. They have shown what is the rent increasing scenario. Based on that, they have done the overall valuation of this REIT, because of which it is valued at 300 rupees per unit. So that is the here are the details for various locations, images of their inside offices and building, occupancy percentage, market value, number of tenants, committed occupancy, then leasable area, remaining lease life, freehold, leasehold, site area, submarket, assets type, year of commencement, interest owned by REIT, all these things they have provided. So I will basically jump to the holding diagram of this company, that is on page number 256. That is important thing we need to understand from this. Basically, who owns this REIT, who is coming out with this REIT. So here I jump to page number 256. Here you can see that basically this on top, it is Embassy REIT, which is holding EOPPL, that is Embassy Tech Zone, which in turn owning 36% into MPPL, 80% into EEPL, which is EEPL is basically 50% of all these assets, 50% into GLSP, and all remaining small units, those are INMPL, QBPL, QBPL, ETPL, VCPPL, GCPL, OBPPL, UPPPL, MPPPL, EPPL, EEPPL and GLSP. All this left side entities are owned 100% by Embassy REIT, and these remaining are partially owned by Embassy REIT. So if you want to check, for example, EOPPL has authorized capital of around 90 lakhs rupees, issue subscribed and paid up capital is 87 lakh units actually authorized capital for that, and holding is basically by Embassy sponsor, it is around 50%. The sponsor owns into this around 50%, and 49% is owned by Singapore company SG Indian Holding NQ CO 1 Private Limited, 2 Private Limited, 3 Private Limited, same name. Okay, in same way all others are there. Here they have mentioned for MPPPL, that is it is owned by 36% Blackstone, EOPPL is owning around 35%, and important thing is that Reddy Veeranna and Saguna Reddy are owning around 27.5%. So I think they will be offloading some of their units into this IPO. Actually there was a news in the Hindu Business Line that they were claiming that some businessmen has asked SEBI that details related to court hearing where Saguna Reddy some amount in the range of around 100 and 150 crore were pending from this entity. Those are Reddy Veeranna, Saguna Reddy kind of thing. So there was a dispute into this, but SEBI had not answered to that query as it was mentioned into that news. So that is some news item I got into the public domain parameter, you can see. I'm not saying that something is wrong with that, because anyways it is in the range of 100 to 150 crore, so I don't think that it will be a huge impact on overall. In any case, it's into the wrong side. Still, I just mentioned this as it was in the news. Then it is UPPL and all other, and their holding and their base capital, all these things are mentioned here. Okay, a lot of basic details and basic things related to this REIT are given into this offer document, draft offer document. They have mentioned all amount related transactions, payment instructions, etc., etc., etc. Lot of things are mentioned here. All these are with respect to that report generated by CBRE and overall calculation related to all these 4, 5, 6 cities, their absorption capacity, overall infrastructure available into these cities. All these things they have mentioned into this report. Okay, at the end they have given the CBRE South Asia Private Limited valuation report attached to this draft offer document. On basis of this valuation report, they have deduced the total valuation to this asset. So this is Embassy Manyata. Actually, it's a huge building, though it is appearing small. So it basically constitutes 40 to 50% of this total REIT. It is basically based in Bangalore. So you can say that it is a Bangalore based REIT, which is spread across 6 to 10 cities, I guess. in India. Now it is actually a great thing for India because it is one of the biggest REIT in Asia that is coming out with this huge amount of portfolio. As it has subscribed around 2.58 times, so I consider this as a successful REIT that would be listed, subject to listing on in few days. So I hope, based on success of this REIT, as REIT, the simple question that comes to mind, that what is different with REIT and investing in a share? In share, you are doing a business and it is subject to the difference in subject to variation valuation to a huge extent, from minor part to multiple times. But in REIT, it is mostly real estate asset, so it won't multiply in valuation to so much extent, but it can keep on increasing, like a valuation of a building, valuation of a house you own. So that is a plus point that gives stability to this overall portfolio. So I hope in future so many other companies like Godrej Properties, then there are so many actual real estate, I am not saying precisely this name, I am giving this just as an example. So I hope they will come out with this kind of REITs. I have made so many videos based on various annual reports and information and understanding I am trying to share with you. I hope you must have liked this video. It is actually a very lengthy video. It is very difficult to make a small video based on any document, because documents carry huge amount of data. You can see that this draft offer document itself is around 500 to 600 basic and concrete data containing document is there. So it will be really difficult to explain this in the time of 1 hour. Still, I'll try to cover the basic points, basic aspects of this document. I hope you must have liked this. Please click on like if you liked. If you don't like, click on dislike, and please mention in comment what you didn't like along with clicking on dislike. Also, if you want to improve on something, you want me to share my understanding with any such kind of thing or related thing, or you have any question related to finance and share market, etc., and overall business, etc., which I can address to, or for which I can search and share my understanding with you, I'll be most welcome for that. Thank you for listening, Share Market Friend.